Well, Wrexham, they've been on quite the journey, haven't they, over the last 3 years following the takeover from Ryan Reynolds and Rob McElhenney, winning promotion from the National League in 22-23 after playoff heartache against Grimsby the year before. And they won it quite convincingly in the end, didn't they, with 107 points. And last season, they won promotion from League Two. Where will Wrexham level out and can they continue their upward surge in League One and what they need to assure to achieve what I imagine will be their ambitions of a top half finish, although maybe Ryan Reynolds might have his eye on the top six, but is it attainable and what can Wrexham achieve in the third tier? Plenty to discuss then on this summer deep dive. Yes, welcome along to this summer deep dive here on EFL Debate, one of 72 we're doing across the EFL between mid-June and mid-July, club by club. Full set for League Two and most for League One uploaded to YouTube and to Spotify. So go and get yourself subscribed. But for now, I'm delighted to be joined by Tim Edwards from the Fearless in Devotion fanzine of Wrexham. Tim, good evening. Really appreciate your time. Thank you for joining me. What's possible for Wrexham in their return to League One?
Well, as we've already seen in the last couple of years, kind of anything's possible, really. Whether, I mean, I think the most realistic of fans will say, let's just, there's a lot of talk of that classic word consolidation, which is great, but you try telling Phil Parkinson, the players and the co-owners that, one of which is actually on the One Show promoting his new film. It's just you can't get away from the guys, even when it's a close season, you can't get away from them. So, yeah, we've made some decent signings, gone about our business quietly and slowly. But when you look at the nucleus of the squad that's there, what's been let go, are we missing the players that we let go? Probably not, but it's too early to say. But yeah, I mean, it's never been done back to back to back from National League to Championship, in three successive seasons. So somebody's got to do it. I'm not saying that we will, but I'm saying that we can, and that's the difference. And if you go into a season thinking that you're gonna finish mid-table or below mid-table, then kind of sucks the fun out of it anyway, doesn't it? It's the same for any team, unless there's somebody completely sold off all the crown jewels and they don't recruit, then you get a realistic expectation of where you might finish. But I think playoffs would be great. Would be a great achievement, the first time of asking, first time in this division for 20 years, and we're not the big fishes anymore. We were arguably one of the big fish of the National League, a more attractive proposition, I guess, with everything that's going on in League Two, but League One, there's some big hitters in there.
Certainly are. Has it sunk in yet? I guess the absurdity of having Ryan Reynolds and Rob McElhenney as co-owners. Are you sort of starting to get used to it a bit more? Is it starting to feel more, starting to feel real, I guess?
Yes, it is. Just because, like I said, like literally they're on my screen now. Just hearing the name of the club just used in sort of pop culture now, I guess, because essentially what's happened, it's whether you like it or not, and you'll get some people who really dislike what's happened, usually with a sort of envious glance, but ultimately, it has shone a light on lower league football. It's shone a light on communities.
Yeah,
It's shone a light
absolutely.
on the kind of the link between the community and the football club or any sports organization. But for UK, football is obviously very, very strong. So I don't think it ever. There's always a moment of it's surreal, of course. And I don't think I think the moment that goes away, the moment it doesn't become surreal, I think that's kind of almost when we kind of lose touch with reality a bit. So I think it's important to go, yes, we've got this and we're dead fortunate to have it. But also by the same token, when somebody posts a picture of a Welcome to Wrexham billboard in, I don't know, far-flung outpost of Canada. I mean, you know, we haven't even like explored the sort of east, far eastern market yet. So as and when that happens, I just think it's, I think it's crazy, but it's, you've just kind of got to embrace it and go along with it. Otherwise you'll just go slowly mad, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. Are you and G still, I mean, I suppose that the question for me is, it's like, I think at the beginning of a relationship, there's this excitement period. And I do wonder, like, Wrexham, are Wrexham going to come to a point where actually the growth isn't going to be as rapid, and they've got to, it's a case of building steadily and investing in a few players that can develop with the club, and something that's a bit more sustainable? Because realistically, you're not going to go flying straight up to the Premier League in however many years. You know, it's going to take a little bit longer. And so actually, fan bases might have to get used to maybe not being one of the dominant forces in their league. Is that a bit of an adjustment, possibly?
Yeah, I think so. But I think that you would like to think that any self-respecting football fan with a greater awareness of what is expected. And, you know, we had 15 years in non-league, and all of a sudden, you know, you kind of blink. It's like, oh, wow, we're two steps away from the Premier League.
Yeah.
As opposed to being two steps away from you know, purgatory down there. So it's amazing how things can change so quickly, and it's important never to lose sight of that, because we could have, it's going to level out this year. There's going to be a run. It would take something miraculous for us not to have a couple of sticky runs this year, where we maybe have one win in 10. It's going to happen, and that's when the realism has to kick in and go, well, we're at a high level, and whilst the squad is very good, there are also a lot of other very good squads from other teams. So that you have to be realistic and look at that and go, well, this is where we wanted to be. We want to be playing the Birminghams, the Huddersfields, and, you know, the Wiggins and so on of the world. So it's another test. It's another test to in everything. Everything ramps up another level. The athleticism, the speed of the game, maybe a different style in play. We've experienced the physicality of the sort of National League, and I think the pace of League Two caught us on the hop to begin with. You know, much more technically gifted than what it was when we left it behind many, many years ago. So I think it will take an adjustment, but I don't think it's an adjustment that is unreasonable. I think you're going to get a few who, and loathe to call them armchair fans, but you get fans that all they've been used to or been accustomed to since joining the Wrexham bandwagon or whatever. Whether they've been floating fans, whether they're new fans, it doesn't really matter. But when you've just been accustomed to success in a short period of time, and then all of a sudden that doesn't happen, it's important to go, all right, well, this is what, you've got to take the highs of the highs and the lows of the lows. You have to do that. And that's the beauty of the game. You know, it sounds ridiculous, but I often think, it must be dull to be a Manchester City fan. It must be dull. It must be a point where you go, it must be dull to be a Celtic fan. At what point do you go, oh, it's another title. Oh, it's another cup. I mean, it's great to dominate, but sometimes now and again, you need something to break up that monopoly at the top, like Liverpool, when Liverpool did it, when Leicester did it, you know, to use a Premier League example. So you need to, you know, it's great to have sustained success, but does it come with a little bit of apathy?
It's hard not to take it for granted sometimes, and I wouldn't hold it against you, because it's like when I think that would be the case for any fan base, that certainly. Phil Parkinson, Tim, how much credit do you think he deserves for what's been achieved over the last few years?
Oh, he deserves immense credit. I mean, you know, when he came in, people were just like, weren't really sure because of how it ended for him at Sunderland. But Sunderland's one of the biggest poison chalices in football and continues to be to this very day. So I don't think it's a reflection of Phil Parkinson's ability or inability at Sunderland. I think, you know, sometimes you'll get managers that they just don't fit the club. You know, look at Jose Mourinho. He's had a couple of clubs where it just didn't quite work out for him or whatever. So you're going to get that. And I think Parky's record is just unbelievable. His win record is insane. It's insane. Like, it really is. I think, I can't remember how many games he's presided over now, but I think it's, I don't know, it's got to be about 120, 130. I think he's lost about 20. That's mad. They're mad stats at any level of the game in world football, honestly. And I sometimes think that if Phil Parkinson was doing this at any other club, he would be held up. He would be like, oh, wow, he is doing an immense job. You know, really, really good. And we look at the likes of Des Buckingham at Oxford and all these other young managers that are trying to be the new breed, so to speak. But I kind of like, I find it refreshing that there's still some old school managers that are showing that they've still got something about them. And Phil Parkinson's one of those. And he's been around the block a few times. He's managed several clubs. And nine times out of 10, he's been successful at those clubs. Bradford, Bolton, us. You know, so we've been fortunate, I think, to
Colchester as well, by the way.
Yeah, and a lot of people take him for granted. I think we're very, very fortunate that we've been able to keep him. I genuinely do, because people would look at that and go, yes, he's been well backed, but he's cultivated a dressing room atmosphere and this kind of bond between these players. You know, you're kind of like the crazy gang spirit, but maybe a little bit more refined, you know, not so ragged around the edges. But that goes a long, long way. I genuinely think that goes a long way to success. And you can buy these players in and they can be great, but they don't get on with the other players in that dressing room. That's when you lose the dressing room. They lose themselves before the manager loses them. So I think he's done a tremendous job. I really do. And I think, regardless of whatever happens this season, next season, however long he's with us, he will go down as a momentous manager in Wrexham football club history, just because he was the one to get us out of there. But then to get us out the next league at the first time of asking straight away after that is, you know, it's the first time we've ever done it in our history. So he's already a legendary manager in that respect.
Certainly is. I think what was really notable, I think what I loved about Wrexham last season, Tim, was you looked at any time you came forward, you always looked a threat. And if the opposition was an 8 or 9 out of 10, and you were a 6 out of 5 out of 10 by your own standards, you could still obliterate teams by just being so ruthless in that final third. And it's something that I massively respect and admire about you on last season. At the same time, there's part of me that has certain reservations, I suppose, about how that's going to translate, where you don't have far more quality than the opposition in games in League One, like you did in the National League and in League Two. So there's a more of an evenness in terms of quality. So I actually, I don't know, I think, you know, are you going to actually need to raise it another level, possibly?
Yeah, I think so. And yeah, I think only a fool would assume that we're just going to waltz straight into this division and carry on where we left off. I think, yes, we've got firepower. It's going to be stunted again because Mullin is recovering from a minor spinal op. So, you know, we're going to be missing him for probably the first 4 or 5 weeks, you would imagine, there or thereabouts. But that's not to say, nothing to take away from the other strikers we've got. So, you know, they've just got to step up in his absence. We managed to do it last year, but mainly from midfield with Elliot Lee and whatnot. But you know, he's gone for quality over quantity at the moment. There were three in, but of those three players have either come from a Premier League club or, you know, a former Premier League winner, runners-up here with Arsenal, Leicester, and you know, obviously the former captain of Charlton as well. So we've recruited smartly, I think, and a lot of people need to exercise a bit more patience, and people saying, oh, we need six players. Like, we don't need, just because we've got offloaded a lot of players doesn't mean you need to replace them like for like, you know. And the players he's brought in are very adaptable. They can cover a lot of positions, and that helps, you know, that does help in terms of when injuries bite. So I think we will need to step it up. That's naturally going to happen. So it'll be very interesting to see. We'll get a true. Everybody goes classic case in the first 10 games gives you a true indicator where you are. But I think it's going to be a bit early this season because we've got some big tests early doors. We've got Birmingham early doors, Reading, you know, to, again, without pulling the kind of everybody wants to beat us card, they do, or a large proportion of teams do. But then the same excitement I get of teams in the past that have said, oh, I'd love to put one over on Wrexham. We now get that feeling about Birmingham and Shrewsbury again, you know. So they're kind of having that. So there's a bit more of a level playing field, both from a playing point of view, but definitely from a kind of like a fan's perspective as well, I think.
Sure. So you mentioned the additions. Arthur Conquo, getting him back on a permanent deal is a great signing. And what I'm really excited about, because I think what you're going to need is players that are going to appreciate in value and can grow with the club. Because I think over the last couple of years, you've gone for peak age players and even some sort of veterans. Whereas I think Conquo is someone who's right at the start of his football journey, and I think he can go right to the top. So hopefully he can have some of that journey with Wrexham.
Yeah, I mean, you know, a lot of people thought he wasn't going to join, but people were looking far too much into his body language at the end of the game, at the end of the season. I mean, you're not going to say there and then, I'm definitely coming back, because you're going to naturally weigh your options with your agent and everything else. So I think it's definitely a coup. You know, it wouldn't have come cheap in terms of the wage aspect. I imagine there's going to be some sell-on fees for both for Arsenal and for us. Well, not so much for Arsenal anymore, but he is at that age where he can develop and develop smartly. And I think it's a wise move for him as well as us, because he could have gone mid to top end championship, but would he have got the game time? Probably not straight off the bat, you know, barring any injury to a number one or whatever club. So it's a good move for him, a really good move. And it shows more about the pulling power of the club. Not just because of the Hollywood stuff, not because of the perks that come with playing for Wrexham, but it comes down to the fact that we got him in for virtually that entire season, with obviously Foster kind of knocking it on the head. He knows his players now. He knows them inside out. They know him. So that's already laid that foundation. And when, again, I come back to the whole team bonding aspect, that would have had a big, big say in his decision. You know, those lads would have been in his ear all the time saying, are you going to sign? And then lo and behold, he signs. And it was a shock to many, but not so much for me, I'll be honest. I was quietly confident he would come back. Really was.
Mm. So in terms of that goalkeeping spot then, you've got Mark Howard, who I think should be a very capable deputy, but you've also got McNicholas in the equation as well, from Ireland, and you've also got Hall, who's from the academy.
Yeah, I mean, we've not really seen much of McNicholas and Hall, and a little bit of McNicholas in the Bristol Street Trophy games, but not a lot. So Parky obviously rates him fairly highly. I mean, how many goalkeepers do you need, I guess? But there's a lot of competitions. Mark Howard's a very able backup, and again, will kind of adds value and experience to that goalkeeper stable with those younger players. So it's a smart move. Will Howard get much game time? He's only really going to get game time in the event, you know, touch wood, Arthur doesn't get injured. But if he does, then that's where he maybe steps in for some key games, depending on how sort of McNicholas and Paul are doing in sort of reserve team games and the other competitions. So, yeah, I mean, we're pretty well stocked in regards to that area, to be honest.
Central defence then, Tim. One thing that's really caught me out is how big a season Max Clayworth had last season, because I think a lot of people were expecting him to be on the periphery last year with the number of centre-backs he had, and possibly even sent out on loan. So he had an incredible year, didn't he?
Oh, he's so good. He's just signed an extended deal, you know, 3 years, which to me is like signing a new player. He's so good. I mean, if he plays the opening game of the season against Wickham, that'll be his 100th league appearance for Wrexham. And he's still only 21, I think. Brian Flynn, you know, former Leeds, Wales, Wrexham player and manager, has said he's going to the top. Ben Toe is obviously departed captain now. He said the same thing. They all say the same thing about him, and you can see it. Like, first season out of the National League, getting back. He got caught out a few times, but you learn. The only way of learning is by playing. But he's put on muscle. He's stronger. He's mentally stronger. He's even said that he's a lot mentally stronger. I think the fella that was at Coventry, I forgot his name now. He ran him ragged a little bit in the game where we actually won in the cup, but give him a good test. But unbelievable player. For his age, he is unbelievably good. Like, comfortable with the ball at his feet. Some of the passes he picks are ridiculous. Brave. Yeah, it doesn't look like he started shaving yet, honestly. But he is easily one of our best defensive prospects we've ever had. It really is. To tie him down to that contract is a big deal, because there are definitely clubs sniffing around him from a higher level. So to get him tied down, again, shows the attractiveness of the club. Also shows the commitment by him to say, look, well, there's only one trajectory this club is going, so why would you want to kind of move away from that? So yeah, it's wild. We're used to losing our best players, not keeping them, and not them wanting to stay. So yeah, it's surreal. That is bizarre.
Yeah, certainly is. Are you feeling like actually one more experienced centre back could be on the card? Because you released a couple in the summer, didn't you?
Yeah, potentially. I mean, obviously, Lewis Brunt has come in from Leicester. Obviously helped Mansfield to promotion last year on loan for them.
Yeah, he was fantastic.
Yeah, but we've got some decent performers there now. So I genuinely don't know if we need another one. We've got some players who can slot in there fairly straightforward. And you've got O'Connell. There's just some solid additions there. Maybe he might look to shore it up again, but I'm genuinely not too sure.
I suppose what I would say is, if you're saying we want to strive to finish in the top half and possibly even be competitive within it, I don't know. I'm not sure Jordan Turner-Cliffe, Ewan O'Connell, Will Boyle are quite at that level. And while Max Clareworth and Lewis Brunt I rate very, very highly after brilliant seasons in League Two, they're both quite inexperienced. So I think, given the resources that you have got, maybe offload one of the other centre halves, but actually bring in one more that's just got a bit more League One nous, perhaps.
Yeah, potentially. I mean, I think they have been looking at a few people. The Twinnicliffe thing's weird because he was released, but it's emerged this week that there was an admin error, which means he's still under contract.
Right.
So there is a issue there. Technically, he's still on our books, but I think there could be some issue as to whether he's going to try and go down a sort of route to get what he's owed. I genuinely don't know. But Boyle, not a great fan of Boyle, so we argue that fact that we do need a little bit more solidity and probably somebody who's comfortable playing the ball as well from that area. But
Clareworth, who I like from that perspective, and Brunt can definitely ping a really good diagonal. I've seen him do that for Mansfield, so I think he's got a really good passing range. So for me, I think Brunt ticks those boxes. I like the overlapping runs that Clareworth makes as well. So someone with a bit more League One-ness.
Yeah, I think so. So we'll see. I mean, it's been, like I say, it's been a slow burner with three players, but the three additions we've got, we're more than happy with. And I think he is looking at a few more, but I can't see us getting any more than maybe two more, three at a push. You know, it depends on how. I mean, ultimately, there's one friendly this week, and then they head off to the States and Canada. So does he want to get people in sharpish? He's going to have to get a move on if that's the case.
Certainly. Right wing backs then, Tim. You've got Anthony Ford there. You've got Luke Bolton, who I think you poached from Salford. And you've got Ryan Barnett as well as Ashfield, who came through the academy. But would you be confident in Ryan Barnett stepping up to League One?
Potentially, yeah. I think, you know, he's got the speed. You kind of, what you see is what you get with him. He gets it, runs at his defender, hits the byline, crosses the ball, doesn't try to do anything fancy. Well, on the occasion he does, he hits good goals on the half volley against relegated teams. But he can still be a little bit lightweight at times. But yeah, potentially, why not? I mean, you know, they look to identify players that can go on this journey. You know, like, does this person have the skill set to do it at a higher level?
Mm.
They feel that he has. They haven't brought anybody in that position yet to kind of usurp him out of that position. So, yeah, I think he could, but I think, like all of them, they're going to have to be on their game relatively early. They're going to have to show what they can do fairly early on because, you know, the League One, let's be honest, it's going to be a little bit more cutthroat if we don't get some wins together early doors and all of a sudden we're 18th after seven games, then things have to change. So, but the momentum is there, the impetus is there, and I think Barnett, probably speed is his key asset. Speed is key asset. So if you've got that and you've got the final ball, which nine times out of ten he has, that's your old school winger throwback. Nobody's asking him to do anything. You know, nobody's asking him to go mazy dribbling runs. It's just there's the ball, hit the byline, cross the ball. That's all they ever ask of him, and nine times out of ten he produces it. So
yeah. You mentioned pace there, that word, and it's something that's possibly missing in other areas of the squad because of the, I guess, the age profile that you've tended to gravitate towards. Do you think that it's going to stay that way where the pace comes from the wing-backs rather than your strikers? Or do you think, seeing as you're stepping up to the higher league, you could do with a striker that can really get in behind?
Oh, 100%. We need a fast striker, 100%. We haven't seen enough of Jack Murray yet to really figure out if he's that person. Dalby is not the person. Billy Waters certainly isn't the person. Bickerstaff will probably be loaned out.
Mm-hmm.
Palmer, we know, is not fast, but then he's never professed to be. So, yeah. You know, we've got height. We've got, you know, we're good in the air. But do we have anybody that's got pace to burn up front? No. Mm. No. You don't, you know, Mullin's probably the quickest in that respect, but again, you know, he's going to be returning from another injury, so you need somebody in there that's going to be able to get that service, because we're fine for midfield, we're going to have plenty of decent service in midfield, but if you're going to unlock some of these defenses this year, you can't just go about it with long balls or you know, the long throws, which we haven't got technically now, but so yeah, we do, and I think that I think if we got a fast forward in, and we got no DLs, people would be more than happy. Mm. It would probably represent our best summer window, potentially ever.
Right. Okay. Interesting. I mean, Paul Mullin. That's the worry for me, because I think if I look at the strikers, like you've just listed them there. So you got Stephen Fletcher there, you got Ollie Palmer, you got Jack Marriott, you got Sam Dolby, Jake Bickerstaff, and then Edwards and Rainbird have come through the academy. But Mullin for me is the one where I'm super confident in him sort of making that step up. But my slight worry would be that if Mullin starts a little bit, well, takes a while to get back from injury, first of all, and then maybe starts his return a little bit on the slower side because of that, is have you got a striker that's going to step up? I mean, Marriott has done it before at this level, by the way, with Peterborough. I think he scored 30 goals at this level in 17-18. He's played in the Championship as well. So I'm not writing him off, but I do think one more could be needed.
Yeah, but, you know, Mullin obviously was clobbered in pre-season last year, and we did all right without him. Large glut of goals was from midfield with Elliot Lee. But then Mullin kind of revels in that responsibility, and I've no doubt that when he's back, he may well be the captain. He may well be be given that captaincy, but in his absence, we're all suggesting it's probably going to be between Dobson and McLean, given their kind of attributes and experience. So it's a weird thing with Mullin because, you know, the people from afar are kind of willing him to fail. Like, well, he's got back to where he should have been with Cambridge before he left. Let's see if he can really do it at this level. Some people are just natural born goal scorers. Of course he's going to do it at this level. Of course he is, just like I expect Langstaff to get into double figures for Millwall. You're just going to do it. You've either got it or you haven't. It doesn't matter about level. It's about whether you can fit to that level. And I think Mullin will. I think he'll play catch up quite happily and he'll be fine. And he's been playing and scoring plenty of goals last season whilst carrying that injury and managing it conservatively. So we'll manage. I'm sure we'll manage. And I think Parky's thought about that. I thought, well, even if I don't manage to get somebody in with maybe a bit of pace up front, I've still got maybe enough there to go. We've got enough to get the service to him somehow, somewhere. And you know, they may well look to convert one of the midfielders. I genuinely don't know, but I think with what we've got, it should be all right. I genuinely do. I just hope. You know, I haven't taken that much notice of how the teams have been recruiting, but you know, Rotherham have gone out and hoovered up everybody. Birmingham have spent silly money. Huddersfield don't want to make a fist of things. So there's always going to be a dark horse. You know, I know Crawley have lost a lot of players, but got a good manager. You just never know. Never know.
Interesting. Mullin, just returning to Mullin then, Tim, what would you say his main biggest strengths are?
Christ, just work rate. Work ethic is just insane. Like, yeah, if he's like an extra defender. I mean, his heat map must be off the chart, but
his leap's incredible as well, isn't it?
Yeah. Dark arts, he's clever. A lot of people whinging about he goes to ground too easy. So, well, does he? And I imagine that there are occasions where he has, but show me a prolific striker that hasn't done that. You know, show me an honest, 100% honest striker. They don't exist. You know, you might get a 90% honest striker, but you're gonna win some. That's the nature of the game. You know, it just is. It's not cheating, it's being clever. If he did it every game and did 20 rolls around, no, our fans wouldn't stand for that. So there's got to be an element of honesty and integrity, but also by the same token, you want to win these games by hook or by crook. So he's very, very clever, backs into his players fairly, very strong. Don't need to tell you how good he is at scoring goals, you know, with his head, with his feet, with his hand on one occasion in the National League. he's just got the lot and
such an instinctive finisher, isn't he?
Yeah, but it's the humbleness of it all. It's the humbleness in that even the documentary, he's like he's not really comfortable in the documentary limelight, really. He's only gone on there to kind of shine the spotlight on the autism stuff. If you really strip it back, that's what he's there for.
Yeah,
that's why he's done his book. He talks about the autism. Every chance he gets, he wants to shine the spotlight on that because it's important to him. Yeah. Arguably more important than football.
Yeah,
football pays the bills. To allow him that platform to get that voice out there. So a lot of people can't stand him. A lot of people can't stand him. But then, you know, if I was in a division with a team spending a bit of money and we've got a goal scorer who knocks in goals for fun. And has become a bit of a cult hero, and then deep down you go, oh, I've heard of him.
Yeah,
I've heard of him because it's hard not to have heard from him because there's that point of media overkill for Wrexham, and I understand that. I understand that it can be very, very, very annoying for any other team or any other club. Really.
Yeah, no, I get that, and I kind of appreciate your honesty because I think for any fan base that's had the experience that you've had, where a lot of football fans of other clubs feel like they do. They don't love the media fan sort of fanfare of Wrexham. I think it's very natural for you as a fan base to maybe get your backs up a little bit. And that's quite the opposite of that's not a dig at all, because actually I've seen other fan bases that have actually had a similar experience, like you know, maybe Salford City fans, you could say, when fans haven't liked the media attention that they've had. And it's possible, you know, in some cases they can sort of feel like there is a fan base is being targeted, as opposed to actually it's just kind of that's happened. Fan bases can't really control, you know, what the ownership is. They can just enjoy the journey. And it seems like that's what Wrexham fans are doing at the moment.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I was gesturing, by the way. One of my friends just turned up. I was like, don't come in because you'll set the dog off if you start barking. So,
oh, right. OK.
I'll answer that in a minute. Yeah, sorry. Just paraphrase that question. I got sidetracked. Apologies.
Nothing. I think we'll move on to midfield and we'll just we'll go quick fire because I know you've got a friend to see to. But in terms of the midfield, then, that's looking very strong at the moment, isn't it, with George Evans, Andy Cannon and George Dobson coming in there as well.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's now raised the question of, well, who goes where, you know. You still got James Jones, you've got Anthony Ford, these players that are no mugs, you know. And Lee, we all know what Lee can do. Dobson, I mean, Charlton fans loved him, but as soon as he signed, apparently he's very limited, depending on who you believe. So,
I personally don't think he's limited. I think he's a very good destroyer at the base of midfield, but I think he does that role through selflessness, not through lack of ability. I think he's got ability as well.
The thing is that midfield's got a lot of bite in it now. Mm. It's got a lot of bite. I think sometimes we were a little bit too soft occasionally last season, but it's going to be well screened. With Dobson in there as a defensive mid. And I think they're looking at deploying McLean in left midfield as opposed to left wing back. And they're looking to push him up.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah, that seems to be the talk anyway. We'll see. We'll see what happens in that. But that seems to be the talk. So, yeah, I think, you know, there's going to be a lot of devastation left in their wake, basically. But bizarrely, I'm kind of excited by the midfield, you know, really am. Andy Cannon as well, you know, solid player.
I like Andy Cannon, yeah.
You know, really made a late kind of run for player of the season last year.
He gets so much power under his shots as well. The goal at Grimsby was absolute thumper.
Oh, I mean, that goal was a thing of beauty. You know, if anybody else had scored that, you know, in Europe, we'd be talking about it for many, many months. But yeah, really good player. So, but that's what we need. We need that competition. We need people to be on their toes. We need people to go, show me. If Parky needs them players to say, show me why you deserve to start this game. And show me why you are the person to step up to this level. Mm. And if you don't, after so many chances, I think we've got somebody in to give it a shot as well. And they understand that. They understand that. So, yeah, I'm kind of excited now. Across the board, we're really all right. You know, we're not that bad, if you think about it. So, yeah, he's got to shift a few players out first to be able to kind of decide on his final kind of squad, to be perfectly honest. So we'll see.
Elliot Lee, are you expecting him to be your main creative fulcrum this season?
Yeah, probably. He had a bit of a dip. He had a bit of a dip sort of turn of the year, but he played a lot of games. You know, stepped up early on in the absence of Mullin, scored some unbelievable goals. And again, there's people in there now. I mean, Elliot Lee's done to Jordan Davis what Dobson will now do to Elliot Lee. It's like, well, you know, let's have a bit more about you. You need to add more strings to your game and really not just chip in with goals, but you got to do it consistently. Maybe get a bit more battling. I don't know. It's weird to say embarrassment at Richards because I don't want to say that, but we're definitely in a happy place. We're definitely in a happy place, and I think it's going to be a fascinating season because I think that League One, if you look at it, it's almost like a Championship 2.0.
Yeah, definitely. It's very strong this season, I think.
It's such a strong division. And it's not a cop-out, but if Wrexham were to fall short of the playoffs,
and people
go, well, look at the teams who finished above. Mm. And if there's no great surprise of the ones we'd expect to be up there, then you go, okay, fair enough.
So that leads me on to my next question, actually, Tim. Is the expectation a top-half finish for next season? Is that reasonable?
Yeah. Oh yeah, more than reasonable. The squad that we've got, the expectation, the ability to strengthen, you know, which is key. And I think there'll be some loans coming in. I think there's going to be some Premier League loan players coming in. I think that's the point we look at that and go.
Yeah. I personally think if we're looking at best 11s, that you've got seven players that could forge a best 11 that's top half standard. For me, I personally think you're an extra four player short, but Phil Parkinson might think more like two or three.
Yeah, maybe. And like I said, we've shifted on quite a few players, and we've only brought three in, so we are a couple light, undoubtedly. So, but you know, it's that weird situation now where people are figuring out where they're going to fit into certain squads. I know Neil Harris has said Bradshaw's not for sale. But then a lot of people say they're not for sale, and lo and behold,
yeah,
they're available. You know, Langstaff's gone there as their main man. Surely, where does that leave Bradshaw? So the understanding is that Bradshaw is high on the list. Same with Joe Morrell. Joe Morrell's now a free agent. He hasn't tipped of anywhere yet. You know, shot window again. Does he force himself back into the Welsh reckoning? Got a new Wales manager. He's going to be casting his eye over all the sort of Welsh teams this year. So. Yeah. Lots of things to consider, but I think anything less, I think if we finished below 15th, you get a few whinges, but then people will say, well, it's a learning curve with this division. We can't always have our own way. But I think if we finished top half, then people would be happy with that. I think if we finish top 10, then that would be more than satisfactory. And if we finish playoffs, then we're on course for something historic, potentially.
Yeah, absolutely. Biggest reason to believe that you can meet your ambitions this season, Tim?
Biggest reason to believe? Momentum. You know, you it's hard to kind of quantify what that means in the true sense, but you know, if you don't get back-to-back promotions through luck. You get it through hard work, you get it through dedication, you get it through application, you get it through the right balance of the team. And we've had the right balance for the team. You know, 111 points to win the national.
111, sorry, yeah.
Yeah, 111 is an insane amount. And then to do it again, you know, with a game to spare, two games to spare is wild. Right? It's wild. I mean, we were like, well, playoffs would be great, first chance of asking, especially after that first game against MK Dons. We were like, Jesus, yeah. we'll take fifth now. So we had a dodgy spell, managed to pull through it. So I think the belief to do well, if you forget everything that's happened at the club over the last year, forget about the ownership, forget about, we haven't spent vast sums of money. We really haven't.
Well, I think you established your squad in the National League, so you probably haven't needed to spend vast sums of money in League Two in terms of transfer fees.
That's forward planning at its finest, isn't it?
Yeah, of course.
And that's what you've got to do. You can't sweep out 12 players after one season and bring in another 12, because that if we did that back to back wouldn't happen. Wouldn't happen.
Absolutely.
You're getting players in that have links. He's got Dobson, who knows Elliot Lee, who knows Ollie Palmer, who knows Owen O'Connell. He knows these players who haven't played them previously. And that's happened. That there is a common theme with that, of having players that know one another and can get on straight away and have that dressing room atmosphere, which has done them a world of good. So I think momentum is the key aspect to it, but also the fact that these players want to be part of something historical. Yes, Luton did it in four or five seasons, I think, or whatever it was. Mm. Three? I mean, if we got promoted this season, then we're in trouble because we're way ahead of where we should be and the infrastructure's not there. Mm. That's when we go, well, if we go down in the first season of the Championship, there would be no great surprise. So then do you weigh that up and go, I'd rather have a season of consolidation than have a good stab at it next year? So it's kind of like a catch-22, really. It's a catch-22, but I'd rather have a catch 22 of this situation than a catch 22 of being in the National League or the National League North. So there you go.
Absolutely. Biggest reason for doubt?
Biggest reason for doubt. Simply because of some of the sides in the division. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of the big teams in that division. There is a load, and there's probably teams I can't even think of. You know, Charlton are going to want to have a crack at it as well. You know, there's some solid sized teams in there. You know, Bolton. Mm-hmm. Bolton will be desperate to go up after coming so close again. So the list is endless. The list is endless. That you can name five teams before you get to Wrexham you think arguably is going to be up there.
Mm-hmm.
And why wouldn't they be? You know, Rotherham, Bolton, Birmingham, Huddersfield, Wigan. You know, there's some big hitters in that division. So that's where the doubt comes in. It's like, how much of a level playing field is it really?
Mm-hmm.
Is it big hitters versus, is it like two leagues in one where you've got these big hitters and not so big hitters? But then you always get one. We think Reading's in disarray and a total mess, but are they finally going to come good on the pitch? You just don't know. So strength through adversity and all that. But that'd be the key doubt, is just that there's bigger teams. Birmingham are a bigger team. That's a fact.
Mm. But
if we're a scout for other sides, why can't Birmingham be a scout for Wrexham?
There you go. Give me a number, Tim, between 1 and 10 to denote your level of optimism for the season ahead.
Eight.
Perfect.
Cautious eight.
Okay, brilliant. Tim, thanks so much for your insight. It's been great to get your thoughts this evening on Wrexham. Everyone go to follow and get yourself locked in with the Fearless in Devotion fanzine. Got some plans for that, staying in action and everything for next season, the fanzine?
Yeah, I mean, we were fortunate to be quite prominent on the documentary on season 3. We had a lot of stuff in that, a lot of voiceover stuff, and they took some stuff from the pod, so that was great. And we've got another live event 2 days before the season kicks off, which is already sold out, which is mental. I've just booked my trip for Vancouver today to go and watch the pre-season game against.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah, you know, life's too short, isn't it? So I'll just get it booked and worry about the damages later, I guess. But yeah, excited. Why not? It's great. And, you know, there's 1,000 odd Wrexham fans going to deepest, darkest Hanley on Saturday for the first pre-season game. So when it all begins again.
Absolutely. Tim, thanks so much for your insight. Thanks to you for watching at home. This has been EFL Debate. If you've watched this episode on YouTube, drop in the comments, let me know how you think Wrexham are going to do next season. Or if you've enjoyed this episode on Spotify, please do leave us a review, because that would help us out a lot. And we'll see you again here on EFL Debate for another Summer Deep Dive very soon.